So I will start discussing the main astrophysical sources of gravitational radiation, mainly related to actually binary systems. I will then focus on the theoretical work that has paved the way to the observation of gravitational waves, and there will be also some overlap with what the previous speaker, Daniel, discussed. Then I will focus on, of course, the first detection of gravitational wave from a binary black hole merger in the science, mainly discussing the first astrophysical and fundamental physics implication of this discovery. And as you will see in my talk, as everybody now is quite aware of, there is a very bright future for gravitational wave astronomy in the next several years. So I want to just start reminding people here that gravitational waves come very naturally in the theory of general relativity, and I want just to contrast, in fact, some of the main differences between general relativity and the theory of gravity in Newtonian physics. So of course, in Newtonian gravity, the two bodies, the attraction, the gravitational attraction between two bodies works through a force. And moreover, in Newtonian gravity, space and time, as we are used to say,
given a priori, time is absolute. It flows at the same rate everywhere and always. And these concepts are changed in the theory of general relativity, where space-time becomes a dynamic and elastic entity and is influenced and can influence all the distribution of mass and energy that is present. Now, we are celebrating this year, in fact, the 100 years from the paper of Einstein that predicts the existence of gravitational waves, although the history was quite controversial as we have heard from Daniel. And the equation of propagation of gravitational waves you can obtain easily in so-called linearized gravity, where you expand the metric with respect to a flat metric or Minkowski metric. And this linearization in a particular gauge give us this equation of propagation for the field H mu nu, and here T mu nu is the so-called energy momentum tensor. So we used to say that if you have a distribution of mass that deforms the space-time geometry, this deformation can propagate away and they can oscillate, reflecting some temporal variation in the matter distribution. And this picture here is from a simulation, I will show it later also, that shows two black holes going around each other and the waves that propagate away. These waves here are what we call the curvature, is actually the second derivative of the strain. Now, gravitational waves are very weak, and in order to produce them at the level that can be observed on the Earth, we need large compact bodies moving at very large speeds, and the ideal candidates are black holes and neutron stars. So black holes are also, as I said, ideal gravitational wave sources. The solution for black holes in general relativity came from Schwarzschild just 1 year after the paper by Einstein for the non-spinning case. The rotating case solution was obtained by Kerr only in 1963. As we know, black holes are just made of world space and time. There is no matter. Light cannot escape from what we call the radius of a black hole or the horizon. And just to give you some number, because I will use them also a little bit later, if you have a black hole which has a mass of 10 solar masses, the black hole has a radius of horizon of just 30 kilometers. And this is very different from what you have for a normal star, like, for example, the Sun, where the radius, of course, is much larger. Another important feature of black holes that will come out, come back later, is that black holes, if they are perturbed, they vibrate and they emit some characteristic gravitational modes or normal modes, quasi-normal modes, that depend only on the mass and the spin of the black holes. And this is a characteristic of a black hole that was first found numerically in the 70s by this author, and then understood also more analytically by Chandrasekhar and the Twiller in the mid-70s. Now, a few words about what we know about black holes. Black holes in binaries, in so-called X-ray binaries, were first discovered, or at least we think they are black holes, the best candidates are black holes, in Cygnus X1. And of course, we know also about from the radio observations that there is a black hole at the center of our galaxy, and we derive it from the motion of stars that go around the center, in our, the central point in our galaxy. And we deduce from that that there is a black hole which has a mass around 4 million solar masses. But until very recently, we didn't know whether black holes in binary could exist. And the main reason is because the only way in which we can measure them, observe them, is through the observation of gravitational waves, because especially stellar mass black holes, we believe they don't emit any kind of light. And this is a beautiful simulation from the SXS collaboration of the two black holes going around each other and then merging, and all the lensy effect of the stars around the holes. Okay, the other important source for gravitational waves are also neutron stars, because they are quite compact. And the first papers that pointed out the existence of neutron stars come back to the mid-30s by Bade and Zwicky, and then a lot of study were done later on. I want to point out that as black holes are, as we say, compact, also neutron stars, if you take a neutron star, the typical mass we expect it should have is 1 or 3 solar masses, the radius between 9 and 11 kilometers, and they are very dense, in fact, almost 14 order of magnitude more dense than the density in the sun. And we don't know what neutron stars are really made of. We don't know the equation of state yet. And in this plot here, it's shown, in fact, the mass of the neutron star as a function of the radius for different equation of state. From binary observation, we also know that neutron stars can reach a mass of 2 solar masses. So some neutron star, some equation of state are already rejected, but some of them survive. And in fact, through gravitational wave observation, we hope, if we can detect a neutron star binary or a neutron star black hole binary, to actually shed light on the equation of state of neutron stars. So gravitational wave can be emitted also from core collapse supernova that form a neutron star. This is an image of the Crab Nebula, or for example, pulsar, that highly magnetized neutron star, which have a deformation on their surface, on their crust. I'm not going to discuss later these kind of sources. I'm going just to focus on the binaries. So the other important remark that I want to make about neutron star in binary pulsars and gravitational waves is, of course, this was also reminded in the previous talk, the fact that binaries can of neutron stars that were first observed by Alcide Taylor gave us the until recently actually the only proof of the existence of gravitational radiation. Of course, since February 11 and actually September 14, this is not longer the case because we have detected gravitational waves directly on the Earth. But here I want to point out that binary pulsars, in particular the double binary pulsar that go around each other with a period of 2.45 hours, by observing for a long time, for 10 years, the variation in the orbital period, we could actually test general relativity with exquisite precision. And here you see in this plot the cumulative shift of the periastron time that can be explained as a loss of energy due to the emission of gravitational waves. There are the data in black, in blue actually, and in red the prediction if you explain this as energy loss due to the emission of gravitational waves. As we will see later, actually today, through the observation of gravitational wave with LIGO, we can do different kind of tests and go even beyond in some regimes to what can be done in binary pulsar. Okay, so this is just the introduction. So there was, of course, as everybody knows, the detection of gravitational waves on September 14. I'm not going to discuss any details about how this was done experimentally, because this was reviewed by Barry Berish yesterday. I want just to say that LIGO is, of course, an interferometer and measure the displacement of the mirrors that hang by wire at the extremity of the cavity, and in particular measure the variation, the difference in the variation of the length of in the two arm cavities with exquisite precision. And here you see the noise spectral density of the two LIGO detectors as a function of the frequency. Basically, this can be easily related to the root mean square of the motion of the mirror due to noise. So what was detected? In these plots, you see the waveform, the data actually in the two detectors, in the HENFO detector and in the LIGO detector. Here, the data were actually shifted by the travel time between the two detectors, and you can see that they coincide quite well. The signal was unexpectedly loud, with a signal-to-noise ratio of 24. I say loud because for advanced LIGO, we would have, at least even for early advanced LIGO, we would have expected a signal-to-noise ratio more around 10. In this other plot here, you see the comparison of the reconstructed template contrasted with the numerical relativity solution, just solving the Einstein equation. And from this plot here, the frequency and the time plot, you see the characteristic of a compact object coalescence, or as we call it, a chirp, as the frequency, in fact, increases very rapidly in a fraction of a second, in fact. Okay. Actually, I want to also say, although we see this plot, beautiful plot of the signal, we didn't really see this just by eye. In fact, what was originally observed, if you look at the output actually of the detector, this is written here counts, but actually this is the strain. The first thing that you see is something like this, which doesn't look really like a gravitational wave signal. But then if you apply, and by the way, this was actually recorded very close to the time of detection. The signal entered the detector around at 30 hertz, at here 200 milliseconds, and then was detected around 430, so when it reaches really the peak. But then if you apply a high-pass filter, you basically remove whatever is below 30 hertz. And by the way, the noise here is mainly due to anthropomorphic noise, in fact, human beings also. You get actually something like this, which again doesn't look like really the signal that you see here. And then what you have to do, if you actually apply a low-pass filter, so you remove all the noise above 350 hertz, and for producing this plot, you also, what we say, widen your output, which means you divide by the noise spectral density of the detector so that you remove also a lot of, like resonances that you see here and other kind of noise. You end up with the green and the red curves here, which are actually the data from the Hanford and Livingston detector. And in blue, you see also the best fit that come from the search that I will discuss in a moment. Okay, so a few other, a little bit more details about the characteristics of the binary black hole coalescence that we saw. So again, this is the signal that is showed in the previous plot. So the two black holes go around each other for a long time at low velocity and weak gravitational field. And what we see is just the last 10 cycles, because the bandwidth of the detector starts around 30 hertz. Then later, just the last few cycles here, we have the latent spiral or plunge, where the two bodies reach higher velocities, almost the velocity, a fraction of the speed of light. And then there is the merger, where non-linear effects and non-perturbative effects become very important. And then the ring down, so as I was saying, if you at the end you form a black hole, the black hole at the beginning is distorted, it's perturbed and excites these quasi-normal modes, and this is what you see at the end here. Now, even if we saw the signal only for a fraction of a second, when the two bodies go around each other making 75 orbits per second here and something like actually 20 orbits per second here up to 75 orbits per second before merging, in this very short time, if we can track very well the phase and the amplitude evolution, we can really extract unique information about the source. And so this is what basically we have to do, even if everything is just in, you know, last just for a fraction of a second. So I want, in fact, before discussing the theory work and the modeling and what was done to extract more accurately the parameters, I have in this slide a very easy explanation of, for example, why the two objects we think are black holes and why there was no actually neutron star in what we saw. And let me go a moment through these very simple equations. So if M1, M2 are the masses of the two objects, you can build the reduced mass, M1, M2 divided by the total mass, and then what is called the symmetric mass ratio. You divide again by the mass, you get something which has no dimension that range between zero when the one of the mass is much larger than the other and 1/4 when the two objects are basically equal mass. Then if you use the quadruple formula that Daniel was explaining before, derived for the first time by Einstein, you can actually get an equation that relates this combination of the mass and the symmetric mass ratio with the evolution of the frequency f dot, the derivative of the frequency, and the frequency itself. There are some numbers here, doesn't matter. But then, just looking at these first few cycles, you can actually extract from the way in which the frequency evolve over time what is this chirp mass. And this was done, and 30 solar masses was extracted. And now, using the fact that for equal mass, this nu can be only smaller than 1/4, we deduce that the total mass can be larger than 70 solar mass. Now, I told you before that the neutron star mass cannot be larger than between 1 and 3 solar masses, so already this tells you that the two objects have to be, you should have at least one black hole in the system. And now, if you just use Newtonian gravity that says that V square, that for a circular orbit is just omega square R square, is equal to the mass divided by R, and you consider that the frequency before merger, the gravitational wave frequency was around 150 Hz, you deduce that the separation was just 350 kilometers, and if the two objects were compact enough, basically this means that their separation would be something like 200 kilometers, because I told you if you have a black hole of mass, 30 solar mass, basically the radius of it is going to be 100 kilometers. So if you have two, it's 200 kilometers. So the only way to bring two objects very close before merging is to have very compact objects. So they have to be black holes. Unless you think that there are some other exotic objects like boson stars or maybe gravastars, etc. Moreover, you cannot have a neutron star because if the chirp mass is this and you have a neutron star, because if you take a mass of a neutron star of 2 solar masses, then the black hole has to be much more massive to give you a chirp mass of 30 solar masses. And at that point, the black hole will be very large and cannot reach such a short separation just before merger, and so has to merge at lower frequency. So basically, you cannot have a neutron star. The two objects have to be, for what we know, black holes. Okay, so this is a very simple argument. Of course, this was not what we used to extract the parameters of the binary, but give you an idea. Okay, so now let me discuss all the modeling that was used in order to detect the signal with high confidence, to claim that was really detection, and also to extract the parameter, to do tests of general relativity, to infer astrophysical information. So I want to do this by explaining what have been the methods that have been developed during the last many years in order to study the two-body motion for compact objects and also the gravitational wave radiation. And I do it in this plot here that shows the separation between the two objects and the mass ratio here. Now, the separation between the two objects for a binary system can be also related to the velocity of the two objects divided by the speed of light. And now let's start from post-Newtonian theory that was briefly mentioned by Daniel in the previous talk. So post-Newtonian theory actually has a very long history, also controversial one for several years. It was first developed by Drost and Lorentz in 1917, and then, of course, there was the paper by Einstein, Impf, and Hoffman of 1938 for the 1 p.m. calculation. Triggered by the construction of LIGO and Virgo and the other detectors on the ground, in the last 40 years, many people have contributed to push these results at quite high post-Newtonian order to reach very high accuracy. And I list here several of them. And the main idea is to basically compute to go beyond the Newtonian approximation. And for example, for the force of attraction between the two bodies, you start adding corrections written here symbolically. And these corrections are very important because in the solar system, in binary pulsar, V over C is not very large. But as we have seen, just for the detection we had for LIGO, V over C, a source that enter, a compact source that enters the LIGO bandwidth, moves at a speed which is a fraction of the speed of light. So this approximation can be used for any mass ratio, but at some point, because you are doing just a Taylor expansion in V over C, becomes not very accurate when the two bodies become close to each other. You can use also another method, which is called perturbation theory of gravitational surface force, which also has a long history that goes back to the 50s and the 70s, where people were trying to extract, describe the dynamics and also the gravitational emission if you have a small body that moves around a big body. And here, in first approximation, you can do this at any velocities, okay? For example, you can study geodesic in the space-time of Schwarzschild, of Kerr, for any velocity. But at some point, if you want to take into account the fact that the small body has a mass and a gravitational field, so you have to take into account the back reaction of that on the dynamics, then the problem becomes more complicated, and this can be worked out up to a certain, or it's accurate up to a certain mass ratio. So also this method, at some point, cannot be extended everywhere in this space. So the best way of solving this problem is to use numerical relativity. And as Daniel was briefly summarized, there was, of course, the important breakthrough after many years of attempt by Pretorius, soon after followed by the group of Campanelli and the group of John Baker and John Centrella. And this was, of course, very important. One solved the Einstein equation on a computer, so one can take into account all the non-linearity, non-perturbative effect close to merger. And since the breakthrough, there was also very important work to produce waveforms that were accurate enough for the searches with LIGO. And here is a picture of a catalog that was developed by the SXS collaboration. And there were also talking about big collaboration, actually, collaboration between people in numerical relativity, analytical relativity to produce catalogs. So there have been a lot of synergy between all these different communities, again, triggered by the fact that we really wanted to have the best templates that could be used for the searches with the LIGO and Virgo, etc. However, to produce numerical relativity waveform is also very time consuming. And I want to show you, in fact, the state of the art of the longest numerical relativity waveform that has been produced today at 376 gravitational wave cycles. You can see here, at zero spin, mass ratio 7, it took something like 8 months to produce. And so this waveform, if you take the Fourier transform and you contrast with the noise spectral density of advanced LIGO, for example, for a binary with a total mass of 45, it can cover the bandwidth completely. But this is just one case. The current waveform in all NR catalogs have only 3080 gravitational wave cycle because it's very time consuming to produce them with very high accuracy. And this 3080 gravitational wave cycle will cover only part of the bandwidth. So we have to do something more to take advantage of these methods. And one attempt that one framework which has been proposed, which I've been very much involved, is this effective one body approach. And let me say now a few words about this. So this approach was developed before the numerical relativity breakthrough and was also took advantage of the work of many people that I wrote it down here. And the main idea is that we want to use the post-Newtonian results, but we want to use them in a, not like a Taylor expanded form, because we know that at some point this expansion may lose accuracy close to merger. And we want to resum these post-Newtonian terms in a suitable way so that this approach, this way of describing the dynamics and the radiation can be used almost up to merger, in fact, almost up to merger. Moreover, we want also to take advantage of results that are known in the so-called test particle limit case, the solution with Schwarzschild and Kerr, where we can know this result in the non-perturbative case because this is a much more simpler problem. And so this approach assumes that the comparable mass case, the case in which you have two bodies with comparable mass, is just in fact a deformation of the test particle limit. So it uses these results and also uses numerical relativity, as I will explain in a moment. So in a nutshell, what this method does is that it maps the two-body dynamics in the dynamics of a small body that moves in a deform Kerr or Schwarzschild spacetime, depending on the fact if you have spin or not. And because we know, as I was saying, a lot of exact result in the case of Kerr or Schwarzschild, we can take advantage of it. We don't need to expand them in a post-Newtonian series. Also, the approach, I don't have time to explain, uses key ideas that are inspired by quantum field theory. Okay. At the end of the day, what we do is the following. We have an approach which is semi-analytic. We can produce the waveform very fast. This is an example of the waveform, and the gravitational wave frequency increases as a function of time up to the point which is called the light ring. Maybe not many of you know the light ring or photon orbit is actually an orbit outside the Schwarzschild outside a black hole like Schwarzschild of Kerr, which is unstable for a particle which has no mass, which plays a very crucial role because, as many studies have shown, quasi-normal modes are actually excited at the light ring crossing. And what we do is that once we pass through the light ring, we just attach a superposition of quasi-normal mode, and we conclude, we obtain the full waveform in this way. So the frequency increases and then flattens here at the quasi-normal mode. So as you can see, the transition plunge mergering down is quite easy, and that's why we can actually model it semi-analytically. Okay, so how this approach was used then for the model search in LIGO. As I said, we put together numerical relativity and post-Newtonian theory in this framework. And what we did was to develop a waveform for actually binary with black hole binary with spins, but the spins were just aligned with the orbital angular momentum. We produced, together with the SXS collaboration, waveform, numerical relativity waveform in various points of the parameter space. So this is some combination of the spin, and this is the symmetric mass ratio. So we calibrated the model by adding higher order post-Newtonian correction that were then fitted to the numerical relativity results. And then we extrapolated the model everywhere else in the parameter space. And this model was very accurate. So if you compare the results with numerical relativity, as you can see from this plot, this was a binary with mass ratio 1, the spin almost maximal. You see very good agreement between this NR result and the UBNR. OK. So I should say there is also another, sorry, There is also another way that you can build this inspired merger in down waveform, which is more phenomenological, but is very useful because it's built in the frequency domain. This approach goes back to papers in the mid-late 2000. And here what you do is that you work completely in the frequency domain, and differently from here, where everything is done in the time domain. And in the frequency domain, you can write the waveform as an amplitude and then a phase, and you do a fit of numerical relativity plus at low frequency waveform produced in the effective one-body approach. And then you fit everything and you produce waveform that, as I said, are very fast. And these were also used for extracting parameters, as we will see in a moment from the search. Now, these waveform models were, as I was saying, only for aligned spins, but the models were also developed for precession. So when the spin can precess because they are misaligned with the angular momentum. And here you see also a waveform that agrees very well with numerical relativity developed with precession. And the waveform is in red, the template and the numerical relativity result is in blue. So these waveform models were produced both in the frequency domain and also in the time domain, and I will show results in a moment using actually this very fast approach which contains a single precessing spin. Okay, so these waveform models were used, as I said, in the LIGO search, and in order to, in fact, arrive to the conclusion that there is really the gravitational wave that was detected could reach this 5 sigma, as I will show in a moment, a model search was used. And so the waveform model that I described before were employed to build a template bank. And what is used is actually what we call match filtering. So we correlate the output of the detector with one of the templates. We maximize on the parameters. And if this correlation is above a certain threshold, then we can claim a detection, as I said. So the template bank is represented here, the mass of the two binaries, although there were also spins which are not represented in this plot here. So the signal was detected here, okay, with this parameter by the template bank. Something like 250,000 templates were employed. And here you understand that you could not produce all these templates with numerical relativity. That's why you have to have a semi-analytical way of building these templates. Now, I want to say that even if the template bank and all the spin align, actually, the template bank was also sensitive to precessing spins, and this is proven by this plot here, where templates that had precession were injected, and they were recovered with very high match, losing only something like around 1%. So the search was sensitive also in the region of the parameter space of the event, also to precessing spin. Okay, so now the template bank the model template bank was used. But now, in order to really reach a detection confidence, you have to build a background, you have to have a knowledge of the background, you have to prove that what you have detected is not just a fluctuation of the noise in the detector, even in coincidence between the two detectors. And so what was done was basically to build a background by shifting the data in one detector by a time which was, I think, a multiple of 0.1 second, more than the travel time between the two detectors. And basically, one, instead of using just the 16 days that of the data that were taken between the two detectors, one effectively used a time around 600,000 years by building this very much larger background. And at the end, this plot actually shows the background here built in this way with this shift in the data in black. And this was actually the event, the gravitational wave 150914. And so the conclusion was that if you want the event, the detection that we had would be consistent would be caused by a fluctuation of the noise if we had waited something like 200,000 years. So we reach this 5 sigma, actually larger than 5 sigma, in this way, okay? Okay, so let me now go on. So the detection, so until now I described actually how we can reach confidence in the detection. But now, if we want to extract the parameters, as I said, we use these waveform models, and the waveform models were calibrated to numerical relativity in some points of the parameter space. But how we can be sure that they are accurate enough for extracting the parameters around the region of the event of gravitational wave 150914? So then what was important to do was to produce some numerical relativity simulations around the region of the event and check that the waveform models that were used for the search were accurate so that then we could use them to extract the parameters and claim that the systematics in the waveform model were negligible. So this is one of the simulations that was done by the SX collaboration. You see the two black holes, slightly different masses and the waves going away from it. And here you see the waveform. Actually, this is a much longer waveform because it was produced starting from 20 Hz instead of 30 Hz. And now this is last cycles and then the merger you see here and the final black hole that forms. And now what is interesting is that these several waveforms were compared to the waveform models. And here you can see the comparison of one of them, in fact. And you can see, again, the numerical relativity waveform produced after the detection compared to one of the waveform models. And the waveform agree very well, as you can see also the blow up during the region of merger and then ring down. The phase agrees very well, which is the most important thing. The amplitude, there are some small differences, but the match is really very good. So this give us confidence then if we want now to extract the parameters, the systematics are going to be small. So here is the study that was done, these follow-up studies that allow us to determine the sky localization, the distance and the masses. So I'm going to report some of these results. So first of all, the sky localization was of the order of 600 square degrees, not very good. And this was also reminded yesterday, was due to the fact that the two LIGO detectors are almost aligned with each other. And in fact, you can see also here that this is the posterior distribution of the Bayesian analysis that was carried out with this represents the 90% credible regions. And you can see that this would be face on, face off. Face off is slightly favored with respect to face on. So basically the binary, the plane of the binary was parallel, okay, to the plane of the detector. And you can see also that two models were used for these follow-up studies, the EOBNR model and also this phenomenological model. It's quite nice to see that they actually recover, they give a very consistent result. Here is the distance, around 400 megaparsec, but you see that the 90% credible region is quite large because, in fact, we don't measure basically at the level of 50%. The agreement. This is the recovering of the mass, the posterior distributions, the 90% credible regions for the mass 1 and mass 2. The median is 29 for one black hole and the heavy black hole 36 solar masses. And then knowing the masses, using numerical relativity formula, we can actually extract the final mass and the final spin of the black hole that formed. And this is also amazing that not only we have quite heavy black holes for the two component masses, but quite heavy black hole for the final objects. The median is 62 solar masses. And something like 3 solar masses were emitted just in the last few cycles in gravitational waves. Okay, again, you can see also the very good agreement between the two models that, again, because they were, you know, they were very close to the exact solution, you know, obtained by solving the numerical relativity, solving the Einstein equation numerically. Okay, let me say something about the spins. So the spins, we couldn't get very strong constraint on the spin. In fact, the only thing we can say is that for the larger, heavier body, the spin is constrained to be 70% of the maximum value, and for the lighter body, 90% of the maximum value. We have no information on the spin orientation, and this is mainly due because the system was seen face off or face on and had almost equal mass, so the effect of the precession is basically very much reduced, and also the signal lasts only for 10 orbits and is not enough to accumulate enough modulation due to the spin. Okay. So now, a few words about some of the astrophysical implications. So the first thing is that the black holes observed have mass heavier than expected, and because from X-ray observation for stellar mass black holes, we typically observe black holes with a mass of 10-50 solar masses. So this was a question, it's an important question for astrophysicists to understand how black holes of 30 solar mass or almost 40 solar mass can form. And so one of the implications is that, as you can see from this plot, where the maximum black hole mass is shown in terms of the star's metallicity. So in order to form these black holes, you have to have a star which is quite massive, and then it collapses and form a black hole which is also quite massive. And what you see here is that for the masses that were extracted, this star's metallicity has to be a fraction of the solar metallicity. By the way, the metallicity of a star is basically everything which is not helium or hydrogen, okay? And what happens is that if the solar metallicity, if the metallicity is below the solar metallicity, the winds in the star are not very strong, and so they don't carry out a lot of mass from the star, and you can still have a very large mass of the star that then collapse and form a black hole. So we got some constraint on the solar metallicity from the masses that were extracted from the event. Another important question is, in order to explain how the binary form, there are two main mechanisms. One that says binary form through dynamical capture in dense regions, and one that says the form from just a normal binary star evolution, the stars undergo a core collapse, they form a black hole. And one way of discriminating between these two scenarios is knowing about the orientation of the spins. If the spins are aligned, it's likely to come from this scenario here. If the spins are not aligned, they come from likely from a dynamical capture, because when the two black holes are captured dynamically, they can have random spins. Unfortunately, we cannot yet shed light on this because, as I told you from the previous transparency, actually, we cannot say much about the precession for this binary. I want to point out this figure here that is taken from a recent paper that came out after the detection, which pointed out very interestingly that we can start doing a multi-band gravitational wave astronomy, because as you can see here, this is the advanced LIGO noise curve, and this is what would be the space mission ELISA, likely, in the future, which will be around this frequency, very different from the one of advanced LIGO. And what you can see here in black is basically the event that we see, gravitational wave 0914, that had masses around 30 solar masses, that if we had ELISA today, we could have observed it actually something like, you see, 1 year ago, okay? With a signal-to-noise ratio that was above 8, okay? And this is also the prediction. What you see here are other possible signals that were computed by Alberto Sessana, which also could have swept in band in ELISA and then advanced LIGO. And this is quite interesting because in the future, when we will have, in fact, ELISA, we could see hundreds of these events, and we could see events even before advanced LIGO, and so even, you know, giving exact information of when, you know, ground-based detector could see events, you know, that space-based detector could see even, you know, months ago, or years ago. So this is quite interesting. There are many cards here. I'm not going to explain all of them. Okay, so now I want to say something about the implication for testing of general relativity. So this is actually one of the most amazing things that we can do with this detection. For the first time, we are seeing two black holes going around each other at very large speeds and merging. We are really testing the genuinely strong field regime that we cannot have anywhere else. And one important thing is that the velocity becomes very large, or more the speed of light, and the orbital period is also going very fast because the two objects, yes, go around each other and then merge. And this is very different from what you can have in binary pulsars, like even the double pulsar, where you know, p dot is different from zero, but p double dot is basically zero. So what one test that we could do immediately is the following. If you take now your waveform in the frequency domain, as I said, there is an amplitude and there is a phase. And the phase, you can expand in post-Newtonian orders, which are just powers in the frequency, as you can see here. M is the total mass. And there are some coefficients that multiply these terms that have prediction from post-Newtonian theory, from general relativity. And so what we could do is to basically bound these parameters. So here is the fractional variation of these parameters as a function of, as you can see, of the post-Newtonian order. So we could put upper bounds. So we didn't find any deviation from general relativity, but we could put upper bounds, which are represented by these orange squares here at different post-Newtonian order. By the way, notice this is 10 to the minus 1, and this is 10. So some of these bounds are not very strong, but this is the first time that we can put bounds on the phasing, on the phase evolution during you know, the last moments of when the two black holes go around each other and merge. Now, I want to point out here that at zero post-Newtonian order, which is basically the quadruple formula, the double pulsar, which is represented here by these triangles, does better than what we can do with this gravitational wave 0914. And this is due to the fact that binary pulsars have exquisite precision. And also, you know, you obtain this result accumulating for something like 10 years, while we saw the signal for a fraction of a second. Okay, so just for a fraction of a second, you can put these bounds here. And this is different. This is something that you can gain after many years, and also with very high signal-to-noise ratio. But you can see here that now, if you go at higher post-Newtonian order, the double pulsar becomes very quickly not very informative, because this becomes very large, while with the gravitational wave 0914, we can still put some significant upper bounds. Okay, so the other important test I want to talk about, which is also unique for this event, is we tried to actually search for the quasi-normal modes of the remnant black hole. So just to tell you again, this is the waveform that was detected. This is the evolution of the frequency that I showed you also before when I was discussing the waveform models, how the gravitational wave frequency increases as a function of time and then flattens at the quasi-normal mode value. You see here not just one line, but a thick line here, which is because what we show here is the 90% credible interval due to the fact that the parameters that we extracted have a certain width and due to the statistical error. So that's why you see that. So now the question is the following. Can we actually say something more about this part of the signal, the so-called ring down? So we measure, doing a Bayesian analysis, the frequency and the decay time of a damped sinusoid, because these quasi-normal modes are like a damped sinusoid, they have a frequency and decay time. And we did it after, you know, the peak here. And we produce this plot here. So let me explain a moment. There are many cards here. So this is the decay time and the frequency. And in black, what you see here is what we would get if we just use the results of the Bayesian analysis, or the follow-up analysis that I showed you before, where we extract the final mass and the final spin of the black hole using this formula from numerical relativity. And then, basically, from there, we can get the quasi-normal mode, the decay time and the frequency for the quasi-normal mode that is labeled like having L equal 2, M equal 2, N equal 0. This is just technical, but is the least damped quasi-normal mode, okay? Then what we did is that we did this Bayesian analysis, and the problem is that we don't know when the quasi-normal mode starts during the ring down, because if you want to be really precise, the ring down, I mean the quasi-normal mode, is when, you know, you form the final black hole, and at that point you do perturbation theory and you can really talk about quasi-normal mode. So how do you link that with the fact that you have a merger and then, you know, for a certain time the black hole you know, vibrate and then settle down to the stationary configuration. So what was done was to change, was to do this search, changing the time, the starting time, where we search for a damped sinusoid. And so we started at 1 millisecond after the peak of the waveform, 3 milliseconds, 5 milliseconds, 7 milliseconds. And this is the 90% credible region again. And as you can see, this region becomes broader because if you move away from the peak, you also decrease the signal-to-noise ratio, and so your measurement becomes less accurate. But at the end of the day, the conclusion is that if we impose that these regions, this dash region, has to overlap with the black region, then we can conclude that there is consistency of the damped sinusoid that was extracted, starting from 5 milliseconds, actually 3 milliseconds even, with the final black hole quasi-normal mode. However, we can only say that it's consistent. We cannot say that we have really extracted the quasi-normal mode of the final black hole, because there is a lot of degeneracy. If you just extract one mode, you cannot extract the mass and the spin of the black hole. And so you cannot really say that that was the, you know, that that was the quasi-normal mode of the final black hole. So in the future, and we plan actually to try to measure at least extract another quasi-normal mode to be able to break this degeneracy and really extract at the end the final mass and the final spin, which will be important to test the Noether theorem and even the second law of black hole mechanics. But this is not possible at the moment. And it will be possible if in the future we will have a detection with even larger signal-to-noise ratio that we had today. So the final thing I wanted to say, how much time I have? 3 minutes. Well, this was reviewed by also Cliff Will yesterday. I want just to say that we could also put a lower bound on the Compton wavelength of the graviton, and on that can be also written like or transformed like a bound on the mass of the graviton of that amount. But I want to spend the last 3 minutes saying about the future. So in this plot here is shown again the noise spectral density of the detector as a function of the frequency for the next few years up to 2019. What is shown here in blue is actually the early advanced LIGO period, which is the one of the first observing run that has concluded, that finished at mid-January. Now the interferometer will come back online starting from the summer, and we hope to reach this sensitivity in green here. As you will see, we will lower even more the sensitivity, increase the sensitivity at low frequency, which is very good to measure even, detect more binary black holes. Next year, we should actually reach this sensitivity here. And then finally, this is the final advanced LIGO sensitivity curve. Now, here you see the how we can reconstruct the sky localization if we have also Virgo, which is supposed to come online next year. And what you see here is much better sky localization when the LIGO detector, the LIGO India detector, will be also included. But this will not happen before 2022. Now, if you look at the detection rates, of course, the one of neutron star neutron star have not changed because we have not seen a neutron star neutron star until now, and they are quite uncertain because of astrophysical prediction between 0.2 and 200. Now, for black holes, because of the detection we have, at design sensitivity, we expect between tens and hundreds per year. But I want to show this plot, which actually tells you the number of loud events we expect to detect as we increase the space-time volume relative to these first 16 days of the first observing run. And if you already go to O2, this is the beginning of O2, the end of O2. There is, of course, also an uncertainty, but you know, you can see from the beginning three events, and the end perhaps 100 events. And of course, the situation is going to improve even in the future. And I want to say also for O1, analysis of the remaining data is still ongoing. Now, I don't want to. I want to also to say that we should not forget that today, we don't have to wait a few years. We also expect to detect gravitational waves at frequency much lower than advanced LIGO with pulsar timing array that are sensitive to this region of frequencies. And in this plot, which I have just received from Alberto Sesana, shows the sensitivity of the European pulsar timing array, nanograv, and the one in Australia. And these are the very broad predictions from models of for the stochastic background from supermassive black holes. And this is the best prediction from the models, but this gives you an idea of the uncertainty. Okay? And this is actually what they claim could be reached in 2020. Last but not least, of course, we hope in the next several years to be able to also have an interferometer in space. And there are very good news because the mission that is testing the technology of LISA actually was launched in December 2015 and is currently in full science mode, which is really very important. They are taking data and they will be analyzed, and the results will be available in a few months. Of course, LISA is more into the future. At the moment, has been selected by the European Space Agency as an L3 mission for about 2034. it's working in a very different region of frequency, so very complementary. I show you actually that even these massive black holes that we saw with LIGO could be seen by LISA, but we are going to see, you know, supermassive, massive black hole mergers, and also in spiral merger in extreme mass ratio in spirals. So just to finish, I want to say that since 1916, so the paper of Einstein predicting the existence of gravitational waves, there have been, well, Daniel said, a triumph of theory, actually, that has been done to aim at modeling the dynamics, gravitational radiation. And I think there have been important contributions for the discovery due to also theory, besides, of course, the experimentalists that build the detector and the data analyst, assessing the detection confidence for the first gravitational wave passing through the Earth, unveiling the properties I tried to explain to you, providing also the most convincing evidence today that black holes in our universe are really the objects predicted by Einstein's theory of general relativity. I didn't talk at all in my talk about new modeling challenges that need to be also tackled if in the future we want to detect and not to detect, but to take full advantage of the upcoming gravitational wave observations. Okay, I stop here.